Lord's gate. Those who are righteous enter through it. I thank you because you answered me, because you were my saving help. The stone rejected by builders is now the main foundation stone. This has happened because of the Lord. It is astounding in our sight. This is the day of the Lord's act. We will rejoice and celebrate in it. Lord, please save us. Lord, please let us succeed. The one who enters in the Lord's name is blessed. We bless all of you from the Lord's house. The Lord is God. He has shined a light on us. So lead the festival offering with ropes all the way up to the horns of the altar. You are my God. I give thanks to you. You are my God. I will lift you up high. Give thanks to the Lord because he is good, because his faithful love lasts forever.
Hi, everybody. I tell you what, my fingers and my shoulder can really tell that I haven't played guitar in a month. I have a lot of announcements, so everybody buckle your seatbelts and let's do some stretches. You ready? Now stretch your listening ears. Okay. There are announcements in your bulletin, and I'm probably going to say some of those, but for this day, I am not going to look at it, just to let you know. That is here. We have a lot of stuff happening, and a lot of stuff that has happened, including Jose. I can't tell. He's trying to escape. But Jose recently graduated from EMR training. So let's give him a round of applause. Yes. Jose, we are very proud of you. So nobody have any emergency medical situations, but if you do, Jose is the guy that can help. Jose is one of the people that can help. All right, we have, Claire needs to cue me because I forget what's next. Good Friday is coming up on Friday. Wouldn't you know it? Good Friday is a service where we are remembering and participating in the death of Jesus Christ, because this is Holy Week. I'll get to that in a little more in just a second. This is Holy Week. It is the week between when Jesus entered into Jerusalem and everybody celebrated, and then there's a terrible turn of events, and Jesus was crucified on Friday before resurrection on Sunday. And we are celebrating each of those moments in the journey. So on Good Friday, we are going to meet here at 6 p.m., and we are going to remember the path that Jesus walked, what he endured, and how we are at fault, how our sin has caused us to participate in that side of things, before, as we prepare for the true celebration that Easter Sunday is. So we would love to have you join us on Good Friday to participate in that journey to the cross, so that we can then participate on Sunday morning in this celebration of his resurrection. Speaking of Sunday, Easter Sunday, 1 week from today, we have several parts of it. First of all, I'm all over the place. This thing is pretty, right? Yeah. This is a devotional guide for families. It is designed for kids, but I tell you what, there's some good stuff in there for adults as well. We have some copies of these out on the table when you came in these doors. This is for Holy Week, for this journey through the next 7 days, walking with Jesus, hearing the stories of Jesus. I encourage you to grab one of those. I'm sorry for my ADHD brain right now. Now, Sunday morning, March 31st, that is next Sunday, we have three big things that are happening. First of all, we have a service at 8:30. It is right across the street. And I have a video that walks you there because I need help visualizing it too, and I didn't have enough time to walk myself, so it's Google Maps walking. So at 8:30, if you want to join us for this service, you can park in the church parking lot, and then Claire will show us. Okay, here we are. There's the church parking lot. You see where we're at? That's on this street right here. Okay, there's a circle. And now we're going to turn. This is slower than I thought. We're going to turn. Wow. Who was clicking this, Sheldon? And then we're going to go through the intersection. So this is you walking. You're walking on the sidewalk through the crosswalk. Don't jaywalk. In front of the hospital. A couple more clicks. We're almost there. Almost there. This is painful. There it is. That is where we are going to be having worship in the garden, is what we're calling it. It is very much a service for you all, but it's also very much a service for our community. We want to be outside of our church building on Easter Sunday to share about the joyous celebration that Easter sunrise or Easter Sunday is. So 8:30 in the morning, we're going to be over there. Your job is not just to show up, but it's to greet people when you're there. And invite somebody. Thank you, Harmony. Invite somebody. That's what these little cards are. If you have one, or somebody handed you one, or you don't have one there on the table outside, this is an invitation card. I'm challenging you all to get rid of this, not in the trash, but to someone else's hands, not to somebody else's hands in this room, but somebody else's hands outside of this room. Invite people. It's as easy as saying, you know, hey, my church is doing this. It's as easy as saying, come to breakfast. Breakfast, which is starting at 9:30 out here in the fellowship hall. Invite them to come join us for breakfast and this service. Speaking of breakfast, it starts at 9:30. We do not have Sunday school at 9. But once more, I'm challenging all of you. We need your help. Because if you're a new person and you come to, let's say you came to, you are at this service or you got invited over to breakfast, you walk in here and it's just empty in here and there's no people because everybody is like, oh, the breakfast is at 9:30, service is at 10:30, I'm going to wait until 10:30 and come. That's sad, isn't it? We want to have a good group of people here to welcome any new people, whether we actually have them or not. I'm challenging you guys to be the welcoming committee. Can you do that? Give me a thumbs up if you are committing to that. Okay. Hopefully I can get a few more of your thumbs between now and next Sunday. But 8:30 service over there, 9:30 breakfast here, 10:30 celebration of Easter Sunday in here. And with that, we have baptisms that are happening. Baptisms are happening next week. How many do we have, Mike? Four. We have four baptisms. And yeah, that is exciting. What better day to celebrate what Jesus has done for us than on Easter Sunday with baptism? So I invite you all to join us, and I invite you all to invite others to join us. I think I made it. Oh, no, I didn't. One more. I'm sorry. We have the youth group gala right after this service. At 1 o'clock, sorry. Semi right after this service. Out here in the fellowship hall. If you have bought a ticket, excellent. We look forward to seeing you there. If you have not bought a ticket, there are tickets available to purchase. This is a fundraiser for the teens, for events that they can do. There are tickets that we can sell to you. There are also a couple of tickets that have been purchased and kind of a pay it forward kind of a thing, where they have been donated for others of you who are unable to purchase a ticket to still join us for lunch. So is the table still out there? The table's not out there. Come find one of the teens after the service if you have questions about that side of things, and we will answer those questions. But we are looking forward to a great meal after church today. All right. I'm forgetting.
Celebrate Recovery is launching April 1st, so if you have any hang-ups or anything, you should be there. I think we start at 6. Yep. You should go. We look forward to seeing you.
Thank you, Harmony. All right. That wasn't so bad, right? Okay, now you get to hear other people's voices. Please stand, and we have our community queue that to help us build our community, get to know one another a little bit more. So I challenge you to go find somebody that you haven't seen in a while or that you haven't seen at all and talk to them, introduce yourself, and talk about what is your favorite part about spring, the season of spring. What is your favorite part?
Nope. Oh, there we go. Please stand as we continue to worship.
Offering?
Oh, are we doing offering? Oh, well the ushers come forward, please. Oh, we're missing one. Skyson, let's go.
Called out. Oh, man. All right. Oh, we are going to pray. Lord, we thank you for the gifts you have given us and the ways that you have equipped us to do your work in new and fresh ways all the time. God, we thank you for these gifts, and we thank you for these givers and the ways that you are at work in each of us and in us as a community. May these tithes and offerings be given all to you and to your work in this community. In your name we pray. Amen. Would you stand as we continue in worship?
Forever God is here.
Morning by morning, new mercies.
Let's sing that last part again. Just our voices.
All I have needed thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Amen. You may be seated.
There are some days, and I don't know what it is, if it's just the acoustics some days. I can hear you all singing some days better than others. Today was one of those days where I could hear you all singing, and it makes my heart glad. As we were singing that last song, I think God was just bringing to mind. I can't see behind me, but I know who's here, generally speaking. And I know that some of you singing that song today, you're singing it because of a celebration of what God has just brought you through. I know some of you today are singing that song as just a pure act of defiant faith. You're singing that not because you feel it today, but because you know it to be true, and you're here nonetheless. And so as we come to our prayer time today, it's such an amazing mixture of things. There is hope, there is joy, there is wonder, and there is deep, deep sorrow and heartache today. There's a lot on our minds today. And so there's a couple things I'd like to kind of bring to your attention this morning. Some of them you know, some of you may not know. For those of you who are privy to the prayer chain emails, I got a call this week from Rob Ramsey. Rob has been not feeling well for quite a long time, and he had a biopsy for cancer on the 13th, and he found out this week that he has gallbladder cancer. Fairly aggressive, what's he say, aggressive and rare is what he told me. So you may notice he's not been here the last couple weeks, that's why. He was in the hospital this week for dehydration and not feeling well, and so as soon as they get him up to a place he's healthy enough, they're going to put him on chemo. But please be in prayer for Rob. I was praying and hoping that this wouldn't be the outcome, but we pray in defiant hope that God is faithful nonetheless. Faithful in, amidst, and through. And so let's pray for Rob. I talked to Carolyn Farrow this morning and last week, and she's having, did you have the biopsy? I can't, sure. She's having tests done for cancer as well, coming up. So we're continuing to pray that those tests are negative for cancer. But in the meantime, will you please pray for Carolyn, for the rest of the family, as they are working through this, and there's some past trauma that goes along with cancer diagnoses in their family, so if you'll pray for them. Carolyn's sister's having tests tomorrow. Carolyn's brother is in the hospital. Yes, I was just getting to that. I was looking at Carolyn, and I do want to make sure that in case you all don't know, Wes is also Carolyn's brother, and so these are his family members as well. So if we can be praying for Carolyn and Carolyn's immediate family, for Wesley, and as he's dealing with his siblings in this situation as well. Not easy. I also got an email this week and a call. We've been praying, for some of you who know, for a member of kind of the Special Olympics community that's close to many folks in our church, named Alan, was diagnosed with brain cancer a while back, and the kind of the newest news is the treatments aren't working. It's getting worse. He's been in the hospital the last couple days, and so again, you may not all know Alan. I've met Alan a couple times, but he's very close to some people, to Candy, to Dakota, I know, in our church community, Karina Bailey as well. So if you'll be praying for Alan and his family as they're kind of in this late stages of this diagnosis as well. There's some heavy things going on in our community. And yet we sing, He has never failed us yet. And so we come to prayer this morning with that in mind, that God has not failed us yet. In fact, God has acted mightily. And in this vein of our gathering together in prayer, we'll gather together here, but something we do during Holy Week and have done for many years is we kind of have a prayer vigil. We generally start it at the end of our Good Friday service on Friday night and kind of ask people to sign up for time slots to pray basically in between the end of our Good Friday service all the way up until our Easter morning service as a way of keeping vigil. We are doing it again this year, and there is a sign-up sheet out there if you'd like to sign up for a time. You don't need to sign up for a time to pray. Please, no, you can pray anytime. But if you do sign up for a time, we will send you some information on some guides if you want to be praying for specific things. So generally during that time, we have you pray for our church, for the ministry of our church, for the leadership of our church. We've taken time and generally do to pray specifically for the young people in our church. And the ministries of our church, all sorts of things like that. That is just a guide for you, but we will send those out to those who sign up. So I just want to encourage you, and I'll try to remember at the end of the service to remind you as well. In fact, Harold, would you do me a favor? Would you grab that sign-up sheet for me? This is important enough for me to, I don't normally pass around sign-ups, but this is important enough for me. Thank you. So I'm just going to have Harold send this around, and just as it comes by, if the Lord so impresses on your heart to sign up for a time to pray, early morning, late at night it might be, but just to keep watch and to keep vigil and to focus ourselves on prayer during that time. All of these things that are in your bulletins and that we've announced this morning can be subjects of your prayer as well, as we lift up our church, our community, and those in our midst to God. Let's pray, shall we? Holy God, as we were singing this morning, the lyrics stuck out to me. Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. And Lord, sometimes that is just our heart's feeling. Lord, where it feels like we are under attack, where it feels like there are victories that we just cannot seem to win, where there are things that just keep happening and we keep hoping that we'll be through it on the other side, and we just aren't. But Lord, I love the lyric that comes next. Lord, you have never failed us yet. And Lord, we cling to that hope and that promise that you have never failed us yet. Lord, we cling to that promise. Great is your faithfulness. Lord, that though the night may seem long and though the night may seem dark, Lord, we realize that dawn is coming. And that even in the midst of the valleys of the shadow of death, we say with David and the psalmist that we will fear no evil, for you are with us. So, Lord God, we proclaim in defiant hope this morning, you have never failed us yet, and we believe you will not fail us now. And so, Lord God, we come to you, Lord, this morning, as you have gathered us here into this place, that we might celebrate, that we might give voice to the hope that's inside us of what you have done in Christ. Lord God, we thank you for gathering us here. We thank you for the mercies that you give us that we see each and every day. But Lord God, we also come as people with heavy hearts. Lord, thinking of our friends and our family who are sick. Lord, thinking of Rob and others in our midst who are dealing with cancer. And God, we lift them up to you and pray for your healing and your presence and your touch. Lord, that amidst the unknowns and the uncertainties and even the fears that come along, Lord God, that you would hold them strong. Lord, that you would remind them that no matter what happens, you are walking with them now and forever. Lord God, we pray for those who are awaiting test results, who who just don't know at this point, and the anxiety and the fear that that causes. Lord God, we pray for your strength and your peace. Lord, we think of Paul and his prayer for the Philippians. He encourages them to submit their prayers to you so that the peace of your spirit may overwhelm us, peace that passes understanding. Lord, not a peace that ignores fear, anxiety, but Lord, a peace that reminds us that in it all you are with us and that you have never failed us. So God, we come to you as a people in need of your grace and your touch. Lord, bring healing, bring strength, bring peace of heart and of mind. God, we recognize that there are needs far beyond these four walls this morning. Lord, we think of the continuing wars that are happening in Ukraine, in Gaza. And God, we pray your peace. Lord, not simply a cessation of the war, although that would be great. Lord, we pray for true peace and reconciliation that only comes by your Spirit at work. Lord, because we are a people of hope, we have been taught by you to pray, Lord, that your kingdom would come and that your will would be done. And we are taught to hope, to pray, and to believe that it can be done here on earth, even as it is in heaven. And so, Lord God, we pray these things in your name, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. And now our kids can be dismissed for kids' hour. Miss Patsy's right here. She's going to bring you upstairs. And will the rest of you please stand for the reading of our scripture text this morning? Our reading this morning comes from Jeremiah chapter 31, and I will be reading verses 31 through 37. The time is coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and of Judah. It won't be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. They broke that covenant with me, even though I was their husband, declares the Lord. No, this is the covenant that I will make with the people of Israel. After that time, declares the Lord, I will put my instructions within them and engrave them on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. They will no longer need to teach each other to say, know the Lord, because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord, for I will forgive their wrongdoing, and I will never again remember their sins. The Lord proclaims, the one who established the sun to light up the day and ordered the moon and stars to light up the night, who stirs up the sea into crashing waves, whose name is the Holy Lord of heavenly forces. If the created order should vanish from my sight, declares the Lord, only then would Israel's descendants ever stop being a nation for me. The Lord proclaims, if the heaven above could be measured and the foundations of the earth below could be fathomed, only then would I reject Israel's descendants for what they have done, declares the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. As many of you know, we are in the midst of our Lenten sermon series that starts on Ash Wednesday and is moving on through next week into Resurrection Sunday. We've been studying during this time and walking through God's relentless pursuit of humanity, and we've been looking at that pursuit through the lens of the covenants that God has made with humanity through time. I might have a PowerPoint presentation here in a moment. Maybe? Okay. Maybe not. Just throw it up there when you're ready. All right, so we started by talking about the covenant that God made with Noah and with humanity after the flood, and about how God committed God's own self, there it is, to never again destroy the earth in the way that God had during the flood, thereby God connecting God's self fully and finally with this creation and saying, I will take my will forward through this creation and this creation only. And then we moved on into God's covenant with Abraham, where God takes a particular person, calling him sort of out of his homeland and out of the place where he lived, where he would wander in the wilderness for a long time. But God gave him a promise that God would make his descendants numerous, that God would make a nation of this person who thought he couldn't have children. Thereby God uniting God's own self, not just with people in general, but saying, I want to see my will and my name known through a particular people, that the world might be knowing who God is through this people, through the descendants of Abraham. Then we moved on to the people of Israel as they are coming out of Egypt, as God remembers this covenant that God had made with Abraham and brings the people of Israel out of Egypt, out of captivity after 400 years, and brings them to the foot of Mount Sinai and establishes the dictates and the rules of this particular covenant that God is making with the people and essentially saying, I not only want to be your God, but I want to be among you. And God commits God's self to dwelling with this particular people and establishes these sort of ways of being as so that the people might know how they are to be truly the people of God in the world. And in the midst of that covenant, God says to them, I want to make you a kingdom of priests. Right? God binds God's self and says, I want this people to be the people who represent my goodness, my grace, my mercy, and the way in which I have formed the world to the world around them, that they might bring the world to me and that the world might see who I am and rejoice in that. And then we move on much sort of later in the history and where God makes God's covenant with a particular family within the larger people of God and promises David that there will be one who sits on the throne of David forever, that God would rule God's people through this family, thereby establishing and setting up kind of this hope that existed within Israel from that day through many, many, many ups and downs, that God would bring finally and fully someday a faithful king who would rule the people of Israel rightly, who would rule them well with justice, with mercy, and with the character and nature of God. And so we left last week at David. David, kind of the prototypical, the righteous king that people looked at within Israel. When people thought about what made a good king in Israel, they thought about David, right? He was righteous, he was good, and he did some messy stuff. We all realize that. Let's not just overlook that. But he remains sort of that one who is listening to God, whose heart's desire is to do what God says, and who accepts God's correction. From David, things stayed in his family for quite a long time, but went downhill fairly quickly. If you're familiar sort of with the history of Israel, David was a righteous and good king, and you had Solomon, who was also a righteous and good king, though his heart was led astray in lots of different ways. But after David and Solomon, things really were more bad than they were good for the people of Israel. They had some good kings after the model of David, right? Kings who tried to do what is right, who tried to pursue God in all the ways that God had asked and tried to be responsive to God's movement and forgiveness and responsive to God's prophets. And yet, more often than not, the kings of Israel were not good kings. They were wicked. They were rulers who pursued their own ends. They were rulers who did not pursue justice. They were rulers who exploited rather than helped their people. They were rulers who exploited rather than helped the poor. They were rulers who exploited rather than helped the foreigners among them. They were rulers who sought their own ends instead of God's ends. And as God had talked to David about, he said that he would not remove his faithful love from kings who erred, but he would punish them. And so we see in the history of Israel that it's a story of wickedness and punishment often. In fact, more often than it is a story of people doing what is right and good. And so we find ourselves this morning in the book of Jeremiah. And what has happened is Israel has gone from being this land of 12 tribes to being a land of basically one. right? The kingdom split in half, and you had the northern kingdom who was ultimately conquered by the Assyrians, and then you have the southern kingdom, and they lasted for a while, just one tribe, the tribe of Judah, and they lasted for a while. They had Jerusalem, and they had the temple, and they thought things were good, but ultimately things had gotten so bad in Judah and with the people of God that God decided that it would be better off to conquer them and let them go away for a while for them to continue in wickedness and an evil among the nations. And so ultimately what happens is the Babylonian armies come in and they conquer Jerusalem and they destroy the temple. The people who said, if we just have the temple of God, we'll be okay. And the people who had done what God didn't want to have happen, saying, well, if we have this building here, then surely God is with us. And what happened is God's presence left the temple without anyone noticing. And the people of Israel were conquered, and they were taken into exile. The most influential in the kingdom of Judah were taken out of the land, and they were brought to another land. And let me tell you that in the history of the world, no nation had come back from exile. This is not a defeat you recover from. In fact, as God had told Jeremiah at the beginning, right? He says, things are going to get really, really bad. I am appointing you not to give good news to the people, but I am appointing you to give bad news, to declare that I am going to pluck up, I'm going to tear down, and I'm going to destroy. You're to tell the people they're to go into exile, and they're going to make a home there because they're going to be there for a while. And so the people of Israel are functionally gone as a people. Notice the progression that we have seen, God relentlessly pursuing the people of God, God relentlessly trying to be their God, calling them to be their God, and even them responding, saying, yes, everything that you have said we will do, but ultimately what happens is God says, I cannot allow this to continue as it is going. I have to take you out of the picture for a while. And so the people go off into exile into Babylon, just like Jeremiah had said it would be, just like many of the other prophets had said it would happen. For the people of Israel, there is little hope in exile. They maintained a distinct people. They continued to be Israel after God, and yet there was little hope that they would return, for no one had ever returned from exile. And yet there were words from prophets that reminded them that God was yet faithful. There were even words from the prophets that came later that began to say, this is not the end for the people of God. This is not the end for Israel. This is not the end for Judah. There are glimpses of hope in the midst of exile that God has not abandoned his people. And in fact, there are glimpses in the midst of the exile that far be it from God being confined to a building or a temple, that the presence of God can go with them wherever they go, because God is always on the move. And God is not bound by the places we build for him. And so late in Jeremiah, a book that has been filled with not much good news, a book that is so kind of down that they call Jeremiah the weeping prophet. Late in that book, around chapter 30, we begin to shift tone. The tone has been judgment, has been exile, has been get comfortable. Like, God, this is your own doing. God is doing this in response to your evil and your wickedness. And then there's a change of tone. And it says something like this: a time is coming, declares the Lord, when I will plant seeds in Israel and in Judah. Both people and animals will spring up. Just as I watched them to dig up and to pull down, to overthrow, to destroy, and to bring harm, so I will watch over them to build and to plant, declares the Lord. If the story of God's interaction with humanity up to this point has been a story of God pursuing, we see again in chapter 30 that pursuit once again. That even in the midst of where they find themselves, they have been punished, God has not forsaken them. God has not withdrawn God's faithful love from them. Though they have erred, though they have been conquered, God has not left them alone. There's a seed of hope. In the midst of the destruction, in the midst of the fire, there is a seed of hope that God will bring new life from the ashes of what has been destroyed. From the ashes that is the history of the people of Israel, God says, I will plant, I will restore. New life will spring up. Just as God has acted for and oftentimes despite humanity to this point, God continues to do so. And so God promises something. And the prophet Jeremiah promises something. He says, and he brings to light in our scripture text today, that God is going to do something new. That God is going to make a new covenant with the people of Israel. That God is going to re-engage with them, re-establish and renew that covenant relationship, but in a totally new and different and unexpected way. God says, I will renew the covenant with them, but it will not be like the old one. He says in verse 33, right, this, the new covenant that I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord, I will put my instructions within them. I will engrave them on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. The old covenant was a covenant that we've heard and that New Testament writers talk about, a covenant that is made in stone, right? That the old covenant was for good or for bad, a covenant that Moses literally brought down from on high, right? Remember, he got the tablets and he brought them down the mountain to the people and he read them to the people. It was a covenant that was sort of externally imposed with its demands, its regulations, and its rules that was imposed on the people for fear of God. And that wasn't a bad thing, but the people could not and failed over and over to keep the instructions of that covenant. As oftentimes happens, we are given a rule and we transgress the rule because it's externally imposed. We have the rule that we follow because we have to, not because we want to. Anybody want to talk about speed limits? Right? We have speed limits and they're good, right? They're good for us. But they're imposed, and when we want to drive faster, it bothers us, and we keep them mostly because we're afraid of punishment rather than we deeply adhere to the rule of law in our hearts and believe that the speed limit is right and good. What God is promising through the prophet Jeremiah here is, again, it's not to say the old covenants were bad or were wrong because God did them, and that makes them good and right. But that God is moving in such a way to say, it's not going to be a rule imposed from above, but I'm going to give you new hearts so that you not just keep the covenants for fear of being punished or for fear of what will go wrong if you don't do it, but where you will keep the covenants because it is intrinsic and a part of who you are from deep, deep down. You follow the law not because you have to, but you follow the law because you want to. And those are two different things that largely depends not on the law itself, but on the heart of those who receive it. And so essentially what God says is, I am going to give you a new heart. I'm going to plant these so deep within you that you will desire to keep them because you want to. And you will do them because you want to, not because you have to. God says, I will give you a new heart. I will put my instructions within them and engrave them on their hearts. I don't know if any of you have had this experience where something moves from here to here, but it's the toughest move any of us have to make, but also the most profound. The longest journey. I was reflecting on my own kind of call to ministry this last week, and When I felt the call to ministry, I answered because God told me, right? I was happy God spoke to me, and I was happy God called me to serve the church. But at that point, I didn't love the church. It was here, right? God had called me, and I was obedient, and I felt it was right, and I was happy to obey. But I remember the time when that love and that desire moved from here to here. I was taking a class in 1 Corinthians, at seminary. And for those of you who are familiar with that book, it's not all good news. The Corinthians were a crazy church. But as I was studying and as I was learning about that, God gave me a love not just for obedience, but a love for the church. And that journey to responding to the call of God moved from here to here. God gave me God's love for the church at that point. I didn't have it before. To where I wanted to obey because I had a desire to see what God would do in the faithful church. It moved from here to here. And what God is telling the people is that God is going to implant in them, in their hearts, so that it is their deepest heart's desire to follow after him, to have relationship with him, and to do so because, not because they're afraid that God will punish, but because they deeply desire and know the relationship that comes with that covenant relationship. I have a hard time articulating this, and so I'm going to have someone else help me. The Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann puts it this way. The new covenant will not be resisted because the Torah, the commands at Sinai, will be written on their hearts. That is, the commandments will not be an external rule which invites hostility, but now will be an embraced internal identity-giving mark, so that obeying will be as normal and as readily accepted as breathing and as eating. Israel will practice obedience because it belongs to Israel's character to live lives in this way. It won't be God saying, do this because, it will be the people saying, we want to live and embrace the way of the kingdom of God. When we talk about the kingdom of God around here, that's what we're talking about. Lives that are formed and transformed in the character of God so that we live in the ways that Jesus talks about on the Sermon on the Mount, not because Jesus told us to, but because they are intrinsic to who we are as the people of God. This represents for the people of Israel a tectonic shift in what it means to be followers of God. And it represents God drawing us along and bringing us along in this process to becoming people truly formed after God's own heart. Brueggemann further says, all inclination to resist, refuse, or disobey will have evaporated because the members of the new community of the covenant are transformed people and have rightly inclined hearts. They will be an easy and ready community between God and the reconstituted Israel. Again, it represents this shift and this change from being because we're told to being because that is who we are in relationship to God. It's a big shift. As I read it, I continually am amazed in all of these covenant little snippets that we have gone through of the way in which when humanity is unable to follow, God doesn't simply reject, but God makes a way. That God essentially does the work. I don't know if you've noticed that in all these covenants. Noah was righteous because he did what God said, but there wasn't much hope that humanity would be appreciably different after the flood. I think God knows this. And yet God continues to reach out and says, I know you can't keep it, so this is what I'll keep. When God calls Abraham out of his homeland, and Abraham is considered righteous because when God called, he went. And yet when God establishes the covenant, nothing else written about the virtue of why God does it other than God wants to make God's self known and does so through a particular people. He gives Abraham children not because Abraham was so much more worthy than other people, because God said, I want to do something in this world and show you that it is my grace at work so that the world around you might see the way in which I bless you and know that I love and bless them as well. So that when you are blessed, they are blessed. On Sinai, the people are brought out of Egypt not because of any particular virtue that they have.
In fact, as we read Exodus, the virtue that they have is that they are the people of God and that God had made a promise. God was faithful to God's own promise and said, I will bring you out, and you who were slaves, I will bring you into a land and make you a people. Not because they're so great and wonderful, but because God is faithful and God deeply desires to the world to be that which God has intended it to be, where people know the Lord. And so God calls this people who were no people and says, I will make you a kingdom of priests so that you might represent me to the world and that the world might know me through you, that they may see who you are together and go, this God who created this thing is good and is for us. And then in David, right? David has some virtue, but man, he is a messed up dude in so many different ways. I mean, let's be honest. And yet God says, okay, I'm going to go forward with you. Perhaps the greatest virtue David has is that when God says you've done wrong, David repents. He's receptive to what God is doing, all his wrong, all his flaws, and they are legion. He's receptive to God's call, and so God says, I want to see other rulers be like that, who rule righteously, but who, when they mess up, admit it and bring the people back to where they ought to be. And so I want to go through you, not because your line is virtuous, but because I am faithful to my promise, and I want to establish right rule in this world. And then when the people and the royals royally mess up, God says, I will do what you cannot. The law that you cannot follow, I will put on your hearts. It's not that you have to follow, but you want to. I will transform you into the kind of people who do these things in response to my work in you. I will put my law on your hearts, so that we won't have to tell each other, know the Lord, because we want to know the Lord and we will do it. I wish we were there already, but we're still in process and God's still working. So the people come back from exile and God establishes, God does what has never happened before. A people who were taken out, destroyed, and conquered, God somehow, by God's divine grace and mercy and power, makes it happen so that the people are given their land back. Who'd have thought? Well, some prophets thought, and God promised. And the people of Israel are reconstituted in a new way. And many years go by, and there is this hope and this promise of Messiah. The idea of a king who sits on David's throne begins to take on different shape, to where people are not just expecting another David, another righteous ruler, but a righteous ruler. In fact, the righteous ruler. It moves from one who is anointed by God to the one who is God's anointed, from a Messiah to the Messiah. It's a hope that God will again restore the kingdom to Israel. Not in the halfway that they kind of experienced at that point where they were under Roman rule, but fully and finally to embrace this wonderful kingdom and the promised Messiah. And so when Jesus comes on the scene and begins to preach and to teach in certain ways and begin to talk about how the kingdom of God is coming near, the people get excited because they have in their minds this faithfulness of God, this promise of God that God will do this, that God will establish a ruler, that a new David, a Messiah, the Messiah is coming. And so when Jesus lines up with his disciples on that first week of Passover, and he gets on a donkey and starts riding into town, and his disciples start saying, Hosanna, and hailing him as king, the people around notice because they're expectant. All the stuff we've talked about is in their minds somewhere. And they begin to shout, Hosanna, Hosanna. Hosanna means God save us, or the Lord is our salvation. They recognize and see in Jesus something. They recognize and see in Jesus the kingly bearing of his ancestor David. They see in his preaching and his teaching and his power one who was anointed by God, They see in his own words, I have been anointed to bring good news to the poor, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, right? He is Messiah material. And so on the first night of power, on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus sits down with his disciples. And he begins to teach them about what Messiah really means. He continues to teach them what Messiah really means. He sits down with them. He washes their feet. This is strange. Kings don't do that. Rabbis don't do that. Normal people don't do that. That's slaves' work, but he does it anyway and says, this is what it means to be a part of me. But as he's sharing the Passover meal with his disciples, after they've eaten the bread, after he's eaten, admittedly, with his betrayer, Jesus does something that has very important relevance to our text today. Jesus picks up the cup. After the supper was over, he picks up a cup. He says, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. As often as you drink this, do this in remembrance of me. You see, all this promise and the nebulous of what does this mean and when will this happen, Jesus said, it happens not only in me, but through me. You see, in this new covenant, the covenant where the law will be written on the people's hearts, where they will want to know the Lord, not because they have to, but because it's part of it, intrinsically who they are as individuals and as a community, Jesus says, this happens in, through, and by my blood. Of course, on that night, they don't quite know what it means yet. But Jesus said, it is in my offering of myself that this new covenant is sealed, signed, and inaugurated. And Jesus eats and he drinks with his disciples, taking on the mantle of the one who brings the new covenant in and of himself, who sits on David's throne, who rules the people, and yet he shows them that his rule is different in scope and in kind, that yes, his rule encompasses all of creation and all that is, but his rule comes not by him conquering his enemies, but rather submitting to death. And in this, we see just how far God is willing to go. We've seen it all along, yeah. We've seen God work and act on behalf of the people of Israel. He rescues Noah and promises that there'll be a future for this creation. He calls Abraham and says, you will have a progeny, you will have a people, and they will have a land. God says to that people, I am faithful to you, I'm bringing you out of Egypt, and I'm giving you your land now, and you will be a people who meets with me, who dwells with me, who shows others what it means to meet with me and dwell with me. And when they transgress that, he goes to a king, even though they said, no, we don't want God. We don't want you as a king. We want a king like the other people. God says, fine, I'll work with that. I'll give you a king who will rule right and justly. When that king messes up and that line messes up, God says, okay, I'm going to put it on your hearts. I'm going to make it intrinsic, innate, inside who you are as a transformed people. And God says, I am willing to go all the way to death to make that happen. For God demonstrates God's love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You want to know how far God is willing to go to be in relationship with the people that God created? Even to death. Jesus doesn't need to conquer our enemies, for Jesus has conquered death. And Jesus has called us to love as he loved. And Jesus sits down with his disciples and he says, it's happening now. This new covenant is happening in my blood. And when Jesus leaves, he bestows upon the church his spirit and says, I am with you even to the end of the age. And we begin to see this new covenant take effect as the people of God submit to the rule of God, not because they have to, but because of the amazing and transformative work that they see in Jesus Christ and the Spirit at work in us. We follow not because we have to, we follow because such a great mercy is given to us. God has poured out God's love and his mercy on us. And we respond with cries of love and salvation. And what Jesus does is extends that new covenant beyond the people of Israel. The promise in Jeremiah, it's to Israel. It says Israel over and over and over and over again. And that's a wonderful thing. But the prophet Isaiah says, it's too light a thing, O Lord, for you to redeem just Israel. And we see in Christ this covenant being extended not just to Israel, but to all who would call on the name of the Lord. Or, to put it how the writer to Acts puts it, that what it means to be the people of Israel is expanded beyond a genetic lineage to Abraham. It is expanded to all who would call on the name of the Lord. And then Jesus puts in us a new heart. And by the Spirit of God, we are changed and transformed and renewed more and more into his image. We follow not because we have to. We follow because he has renewed us and shown us what is good. Because it's who we are as the people of God. Have we seen the fullness of this covenant in effect yet? Not quite. But the hope we have is that the God who has pursued us thus far will pursue us all the way to the end. We have a little glimpse of that in the book of Revelation. Read it. It's a good book. Talk to Harold about it. He'll tell you why it's a good book. Because it shows the kingdom of this world becoming fully and finally the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, where all is transformed and made new, where we will not need to say to one another, know the Lord, for we will know him from the least to the greatest. The new covenant is inaugurated and begun in Christ, and we as his people await for it in its fullness. As we ask and receive wisdom and guidance on how we might be formed more fully and completely into the people after his own image. How far is God willing to pursue us? All the way to the end. And at the right time, Jesus did what we could not. He was faithful where we have failed. And so we live not on our own merit, but on the faithfulness of the one who has gone before. All of this because God has offered us forgiveness in Christ. And by way of celebrating what God has done in Christ this morning, we're going to take communion together. For it was at that meal with his disciples that Jesus said, "This is the new covenant in my blood." It is at that moment Jesus declares that the table is open and invites us all to it. It is in this act, as we remember what God has done in Christ, that we declare anew that we desire deeply to be his people, formed after his name. That we too might not simply be a people who are saved, although that's awesome and right and good, but that we are a people who are called like Israel before us, or as a part of the newly constituted Israel, that we are called to be a kingdom of priests. A people formed after Christ's image, that we might, in our word and in our deed, demonstrate to the world what it means to live in community and relationship to Almighty God. That through us, God might invite others into his family. Remind you that you don't need to be a member of this church or a member of any church, for that matter, to receive the gifts that we have as we remember the broken body and shed blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. We need only to desire the life and salvation that God gives, the forgiveness of our sins in the work, in the death, and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. The worship team's going to come back up. And I didn't ask anyone to help me, but James, are you willing? James. always willing. Thank you, James. Remind you that as you come forward and when you've been invited to come up this row, receive the bread and the cup, and then take it with you and be seated, and then once we have all been served, we will partake of the communion meal together. Let us pray. Almighty God and gracious Father, we give you thanks and we give you praise. We thank you for the promise of this new covenant in your blood. We thank you that you have done for us what we could not do for ourselves. Lord, we submit ourselves to you anew today, recognizing that it is in your grace and by your mercy and by your Spirit that we are formed and transformed into a people after your name. Lord, we invite you anew to continue to write your covenant on our hearts. Lord, we are grateful and we are thankful for what you have done for us. We thank you that on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and he gave thanks and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples saying, "This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." We remember that likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from it, all of you. This is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." And so we gather here as the body of Christ to offer ourselves to you, Lord God, and in praise and in thanksgiving. We pray that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these your gifts. Make them by the power of your Spirit be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ that is redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one in Christ, one with each other, and one in the ministry of Christ to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory. Lord God, we give you thanks. We give you praise. We thank you for these, your gifts. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. I would invite you to come and receive his grace today. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas great that taught my heart to feel, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life
Does what we cannot do for ourselves. In Christ, God goes the full length. God is faithful where we were not. But in so doing, in the death and resurrection of Christ, we are enabled to be faithful in his name by his Spirit. All because Christ has died and Christ has risen. And we declare in faith that Christ will come again. And so we remember. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples. He said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Take, eat, and receive his grace today." And likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he blessed it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." So this is the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Take and drink and receive his grace today. As we close, I'd like you to stand, and I'm going to ask Sheldon, can you come up and lead us in the chorus of Great is Thy Faithfulness again? By way of declaring our faith in the one who has done this for us, let us sing together, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Go in the love, the grace, in the name of the one who is faithful. For God, who calls you, is faithful, and who will do this in you. You're dismissed. Go in grace and peace and serve the Lord.